Please bring to the stage Mr. William Salyers and Cortenay Salyers. I need a line of Q&A up right up this side. If you have any questions for Mr. Salyers? Say it again for me one more time.
Salyers.
We were blue in his backstage. I just have not had enough coffee yet today.
I'll answer to Bill. Have. That's fine.
Bill, all right. Bill and Cortenay, if you guys want to create a line for questions over here, I'm going to start asking the first filler questions. How are you guys doing today?
I'm almost awake.
I had no coffee.
It's that,
there's
that
coffee coming.
First Q&A of the day.
Throw some softballs.
Exactly.
Is this your first trip down to Miami?
Yes.
Me too.
Yes, first time in Florida.
You should come back when it's warm.
Okay. I was laying out yesterday with the storm clouds coming over. I don't care. I'm here for the experience. Doesn't matter what's happening up there.
Well, this time of year, actually, partly cloudy is my favorite.
Your humidity got so thick that it's actually falling from the sky.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Well, it's not a hurricane. That's what we call it today.
Not a hurricane.
Not a hurricane.
Makes it a good day.
All right. So tell us the beginnings of how you hooked up with the regular show.
It sounds dirty.
Well, I always
thought
it was cute, and you know, we'd made eyes at each other across the room.
A couple of drinks. Regular show was like, "Hey, how you doing?" You go first because it's more interesting.
I don't know. Read for it. I did, but I went and I got this audition. When you're a voice actor, you'll get copied. Sent to you from your agent, so you'll get a few lines of something. But everybody's always really tight-lipped about what they're auditioning you for. So I got this script with lines like, two ties, you don't know what I'm going to throw next, baby. And I had no idea what that meant. I'm like, are you talking railroad ties, zip ties? What are you talking about? And so it just seemed kind of like angsty material, you know? It seemed like it was coming from somebody who really didn't have their zen on. So I just kind of went with this voice. Two ties! You don't know what I'm going to throw next, baby! And that must have been the right answer because that got me in the pilot. And then they called me back. As they often do, they re-auditioned for the series once it got picked up. And they called me back in, and I got to do the ham-boning. And that was fun. I actually got so excited. Here's a tip for you. If you ever do a voiceover audition, if you have to ham bone, don't get all excited and actually slap yourself. That's frowned upon. And that's what I did.
And bruise.
And bruise, yeah. So I was having so much fun reading the material. So I'm actually going, you know, ham boning will save your life someday. It'll be all like, what? You're trying to mug me? And so the casting director was like, JG laughed. The casting director was like, that's great. Can you do it again? And don't slap yourself.
Easy, Celine Dion.
Yeah, yes, exactly. So anyway, that's my story. That's how I ended up playing Rigby.
I think don't slap yourself is just good advice for any situation.
I should start a t-shirt line.
Don't slap yourself.
Yeah.
I actually remember I'm pretty sure that I auditioned for Rigby the first round. I do actually remember the packet going out. Clearly I didn't get it, but, whatever. It was the third season, I think.
Yeah.
I got called to, audition for, a character named Starla and, a cashier character. And I think I just did kind of a regular voice for Starla. And then I made the cashier like, you have to come up front and pick up your stuff. And, I went in, they said, you got the role, and I went in, and I was like, oh, you know, Starla, what did I do for Starla? She was kind of sweet-sounding, and they're like, oh, no, we don't want that voice, we want the cashier's voice for Starla. I said, great, so I came in, I did a little Starla, I also did, they called me in a couple weeks later, I think, for the Scabatha, and I cannot remember her name, but the two girls in the flying car, the English punk rock chicks. And I was like, I'm in. I love this show. Let's do this thing.
All right. So now we got a nice little line of questions going. What would your question be for?
All right. So occasionally you and Mark Hamill work in the same building, so... Do you hear any insider info on the new Star Wars?
That's a great question, and not a bit. He is so incredibly tight-lipped about that. And, you know, it's hard to fight the impulse to want to draw him out a little bit, like, hey, where you been, Mark? Made any fun overseas trips lately? But he's...
Pinewood?
Yeah, exactly. Pinewood.
What does it mean to you? Pinewood!
Yeah, exactly. He's very tight-lipped about it. He did start coming in. We were seeing him less frequently as he ramped up for the movie. And then, like, suddenly, like, he's losing weight, and he's starting to look remarkably like a younger Mark Hamill. And we were all like, oh, I'm starting to get it. But he does not talk about it at all.
I actually have one of my girlfriends is on the casting team for the movie. Huh. This is just a little aside. But I have tried everything to get information out of her. I'm like, here, have more cocktails. Here, no. Just like back rubs and stuff. I'm like, so what's going on? What are you doing? What are you working on? Nothing. They're all like fembots or something. Yeah. They will say nothing. If I can't get it out of them, no one can.
That non-disclosure agreement must involve like blood of firstborn or something because
totally.
Nobody is breaking it.
Organs. It involves organs.
Thank you very much.
He's like, on that note.
Yeah, cool.
Wrap it up.
Hi. My question is, for the two of you, did you two know each other before you did the regular show? And did any other cast members know each other, or you just kind of got thrown in one room?
Are you a plant? Did they plant you out there?
Thank you. I'll give you your $20 later, because I love this story. So Bill and I actually do happen to know each other from before the regular show. We worked on a little show called iCarly together.
Yes, I believe the episode was called I Cook.
It was I Cook. It was a play on the Iron Chef franchise where the kids from iCarly were going up against an actual chef with their spaghetti tacos, and they brought in three judges. So I played Paula Abdul's character, essentially, Judge Marla.
And I was Judge Philippe.
Yes, and so we had to sit there for, I don't know, 10 hours on set picking around the coldest, greasiest prop spaghetti tacos.
Yeah, they kept walking up to us and saying, I'm sorry, you have to actually eat these in the shot. Because we were like,
it was so gross.
Yum!
It was literally like, get a spit bucket.
They're like, put it in your mouth. Chew! Chew!
And the best part was that during our lunch break, Bill and I were talking, and he was talking about how he wanted to get into voiceover.
Yeah, Cortenay was the established professional, and I was just kind of starting to get involved in VO. So
we had a nice chat. I gave him some pointers.
She told me that it was great.
And then a couple of years later, I was terribly nervous going in for my first episode of regular show. And I walked in and I'm like, are you serious? You're the lead? And I was giving you pointers. He's like, well, I wasn't then. And I'm like, okay, well, now I feel like an idiot. Give me some pointers.
Well, so, obviously the pointers worked. So
I know. So I get 10% of everything he makes now. It's amazing.
So ask her for advice, because you end up on a show.
That's right. Yes, sort of.
Hey, guys.
Hi.
Like your attire.
Thank you.
Beautiful.
My question to both of you was that I've been talking to a few other voice actors. I've been going to a bunch of different conventions over the past couple of years. And weirdly enough, they're very similar to the characters that they play, like, personality-wise and, like, experiences and
stop
stuff.
Stop talking!
And stuff like that. Are you guys, like, do you guys share, like, different similarities as your characters that you play on regular show, like Rigby?
God, I hope not. Well, I mean, you could see how Starla-like this lovely young lady is.
I cover up the green with a little foundation, but...
For me, Rigby is acting out everything that I want to do, but don't let myself because I have to live with people. But, you know, it's like, you know, Bill tries to be like, no, I've had too much pizza, you go ahead. And my inner Rigby is saying, I want the last piece!
And I think my husband would say, definitely, on a bad day, I can be like Starla, like, just kind of going along, and then all of a sudden, like, you know, tell me how you feel about me! I don't understand! Talk to me! And he'll just be like, what happened? And, you know, like, the next day it'll be fine, and then it'll just turn on a dime. So, yeah, I probably have that in me a little bit.
I've got a 15-year-old boy, and I tend to look to him a lot for inspiration for Rigby. When we say things like, yeah, you could totally go hang out with this other kid, but you have to clean your room before you do that. And he goes, ugh.
Is there any give and take with the writer's room? Do they start writing the characters either to play to a punchline you hit well, or because you made the mistake of having lunch with them and then your life ends up in the show?
I think they tend to base it more on the lives of their sort of friends and who they went to school with. But what they will do, and they've said this before, is it's a really tightly scripted show, and that JG knows what he wants, which is why it's so successful. But the writers have said before that once they come into the room, and they visit the booth a lot to hear us, and they start writing towards our strengths. And so the character ends up being an amalgam of what you bring and what they see in you that they like. Does that make sense?
Yes. Don't be good at something you don't want to do again.
Yeah, exactly. That's right.
Hello. So I'm an aspiring actress and what? Do what? Stand up? What?
No, I'm just loving your garb.
Thanks. I'm an aspiring actress, but I've mostly been trying to do on-screen stuff. But I've always loved voice acting, and I've heard it's really hard to get into because you have to have a world of different dialects and accents. And I just wanted to know your opinion on it, because obviously you're successful and we love you. So.
Absolutely. If you don't have a ton of things, you can just pull right out of your arse.
Yeah.
No. I actually, Cortenay might be better to answer this because she actually gets her whole body on television. And I don't do that often. So what would you say to somebody who wants to do both?
To do both? I think it's super smart. I mean, I don't do a ton. I do I did Criminal Minds a couple of months ago, and I do some TV shows and occasional indie movies and stuff. But I think with everything else, just because all acting is the odds are kind of stacked against you. I mean, it's luck and preparation and being ready and you know, so many factors. But I say diversify. You know, as an actor, you're going to get a large amount of rejection, and there's nothing that you can do about that. But you can, what seems to work for me is to say, okay, I'm going to put it out in as many different areas as I can. And that way, if I don't get, you know, the guest star on CSI, then maybe I get a video game that I really wanted, or I get to go and do a small film or something like that. So for me, it's not so much about the level of what I'm doing or the amount of accolades. It's the fact that I got a yes and a bunch of no's. And so trying to kind of gird your loins that way is helpful. And then I think so much of it is, who was, you'll know this, the quote, 90% preparation.
10% inspiration.
It's that, be prepared. Do absolutely everything. Don't, I mean, Hollywood loves to make it everyone just came in and fell off this turnip truck. You know, he was a model, and all of a sudden he's a huge star. And that's really
not true.
I was not
a model. I was never a model.
He did a little modeling. But they like to make it seem like it's magical and effortless. And, you know, so you get caught up in that whole thing of oh, this person's just so pretty. They got to do this thing. When so many people have really put in a lot of, there's no overnight successes. Very few overnight successes. So go to class. Do as much work as you can. Be prepared. Be professional. Be professionally persistent and not annoying. And you know, just keep, if it's really what you want to do, do it. And if it's really, if it comes to a point where it's not what you want to do, go do something that you love.
Yeah, I could tell you a quick Debbie Downer story about that, though we all have many. I had gotten cast in my first cartoon, which was an Adult Swim show called Moral Oral. And so I was on a show. I was working regularly, and a friend walked me into his agent, which means basically they're bringing you in on their reputation and saying, hey, this guy's great, you want to consider him. Walked me into William Morris, which that was before it was William Morris Endeavor. And I said, look, I'm on this show. Nobody's got any of it. Here, 10% just for taking me on. And they're like, yeah, no. So I was actually on a show and I couldn't get representation. So that's how hard it can be.
Free money.
Yeah, free money. They turned down free money.
You think they would do that, but you know, it's very, very competitive. And so you do have to want to love to do it. And it doesn't, you get to a certain level and you think it's going to be like, people ask all the time, like, so, you know, when they give you, somebody asked me yesterday, like, does BioWare give you roles? And I was like, no. Like, I've worked for them quite a bit, and no. I still have to audition for everything.
Have you ever gotten any indication why the bigger agencies, the bigger rep houses, seem to have a headcount limit? Like, why not have an extra 1,000 people laying around?
Well, I think it's because then you run into the problem of you've got your own people competing against each other. And then and then that gets awkward for them, you know, when you're seeing your doppelganger in the office and also getting cast. I think they do try to sort of, like, only have a handful of the same type at any given time.
They want to be able to service no matter how big they are. I actually was at William Morris, and
nice.
Even though they're a huge agency, they do want to have like only a certain amount of people, because they do want to service you well and make sure that you're working, because otherwise you will leave. They don't have all the power. You can say I'm not happy and go, and they will have lost something.
I've been told, by the way, that I could probably get them now, but screw them.
I'm pretty sure I can get you in there.
Yeah. No, it's too late.
Next.
Okay, so question, since you brought up video games and BioWare and everything, obviously Mass Effect, love the game, love
Thank
the series
you.
And everything.
Thank you.
My first question, big important one, how engaged were you in the actual storyline? Is this something that you just came in and read lines, or did you actually get into the lore and understand the characters and really play them?
You want to take that one first?
For me, That's a great question. For me, it was kind of a trippy thing because I had not played that particular franchise. And my agent, again, you know, they hit me with copy and they said, you're playing this type of character. He's a scientist and he's a Salarian. And I prepped for the character, and they had reference material, actual voice of a character. And I thought that they were saying, you're playing another character of this type, of this species. So then I come in and I find out that I'm actually voice matching another actor. And I found that out at the audition. Luckily, I sounded quite a bit like the guy who had established the part. But that was awkward for me to begin with, because it really, I mean, you never feel great about replacing somebody, but the other side of that is you have to figure that there's a reason they're not there. And that particular director was great to work with. You probably remember her name, I don't.
Caroline Livingstone.
Was great to work with, and I've never met her. For me, she was calling in from Canada. What was great was the particular software they were using, we could actually hear the cue. Like, I would hear Shepard's line before I would reply as Morden. And I got completely absorbed in it. I mean, to this day, for me, that death scene is one of the most enjoyable pieces of work I've ever done.
What he's talking about is, it's a machine called a Veda, and it's actually so helpful for voice actors to be able to do that, because normally we might have somebody who's a director who's just doing the lines, and they don't maybe know how the person is either going to deliver them or did deliver them.
Or you just have that Excel spreadsheet of just your lines.
Right, and somebody shaking a cursor going, click, again. As far as, I had no idea what Mass Effect was, and I had no idea what... Obviously, Jack was a new character, so I didn't know what I was getting into. And I had no idea about... I had auditioned for another game of BioWare's prior, but I didn't know anything about the Mass Effect series. I got very involved in Jack, and then I didn't... And it took me a while to kind of start to understand. It was interesting. They were actually so thorough that I didn't... they gave me so much information about it that I actually felt like... Even though I didn't know who she was in the beginning, that it was a pretty, I felt like I kind of knew what I was doing. As obviously, my husband's a huge fan, and he didn't marry me because of me being Jack. That would be weird. I was married before that. But so now I've actually sat with him, and I've tried to play through. I'm not smart enough, but I've watched him play through, and I know, I'm certainly no expert on it, but I do get the whole, I understand why fans are so hooked in and how amazingly cinematic and great it is, so.
Wait, tell that story the other way around. So your husband was already hooked on a video game, and then you got that gig?
No. He's a huge fan, but he didn't know about Mass Effect either until I did it.
Oh.
No, there's no weirdness there. He didn't. He wasn't like, hey, shepherd adjacent.
Okay. All right, so then I was allowed a follow-up question. I have a question specifically for Morden. Do you remember the I Am a Very Model of a Scientist Salarian song?
That one I have not learned. I can do one for you, but it's from later in the game. I can do the better to die to a thresher maw with shotgun blasting roaring raw than to play ambassadorial games with the blood of Shiaga in her veins.
Awesome.
So that's
again, it sounds very Gilbert and Sullivan.
Well, and that's the point.
He's classically trained.
That was specifically it. Was the character was supposed to be a GNS fan?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Quick question, then, and then I'll walk off. If I were to give you the lyrics to that portion of the song, the scientist there, would you be able to sing it?
Let me rescue this for you from this. I've tried to read a cell phone underneath that stage lighting. I'm the one who made the stage lighting. I can tell you they're blind.
Yeah, let's
give
you
him
know
a couple
what?
Hours to work on it.
Yeah,
and we'll sing it to you at the
come by the signing line. And we'll try it.
Yeah, that's better lighting to read a screen.
This is a question for the both of you. If you could choose to cure the genophage, would you have done it?
That's a great question.
What
would you if you could have? Would you have chosen to cure the genophage, the virus that was destroying everybody?
You go.
Yeah. I mean, I sort of feel like of the characters that I've played, I don't know that this may be. I'm not trying to be egotistical. I'm not as smart as any of those people. But I relate to Morden probably more than most of the characters I've played, certainly more than Rigby. I mean, I think you have to do what you can, and I think that would come under that heading.
I don't know that would be in Jack's sort of lexicon, but I think yes, you always obviously should, but
and of course,
I think Jack would try and kill it. So,
of course, Morden has literally had a particular burden of guilt about that. So, yeah. You know, if I was coming from his point of view, I would definitely try to cure it.
Thank you.
Hello. I technically have a two-part question. The first one is for both of you. How do you get along with like the rest of the cast? Mostly with Mr. Sayers, how you get along with Mordecai's voice actor and Benson's voice actor, because, you know, Mordecai's the best friend, then Benson's the boss who's always yelling at you. And, of course, Mrs. Taylor with how you get along with Muscle Man's voice actor.
Make something up, dude. Make it good, because, you know.
Yeah, they're nice.
I mean.
You know, everybody, like, bathes, so that's a bonus. Now, actually, J.G. Quintel, who is the voice of Mordecai, is also the creator of the show. He voices Mordecai in High Five Ghost. And Promise Pie, which is one of my favorite lesser-known characters.
Promise Pie.
Promise Pie.
JG is the nicest guy in the world. He is one of these weirdly successful guys when you meet him and you're like, gosh, I hope there's something to dislike because you're just incredibly successful. And there's not. He's just a great, great guy. If he's ever lost his mind, I've never seen it happen. So, yes, I get along great with him. Sam... And Courtney could address this more. One of my favorite things about Sam is that he's a very, very quiet guy. Now, you're talking the guy that does the voice of Benson and Pops and Muscle Man, right? So Sam comes in, and he wears glasses typically. So Sam comes in. Hey, Sam, how you doing? Fine. You having a good day? Yeah. My mom! I mean, It is the most amazing thing to watch this guy just transform in front of the mic, and he does.
I'm obsessed with him. I am. I'm obsessed with him.
That's appropriate.
Like, I think I make him really uncomfortable. First of all, everybody on that show, and this is not BS, everybody on that show is so cool. They have a rotating, you know, ancillary cast members that come in all the time, and it's like a freaking party every time.
And is it a prelay show? Are you all in the room at the same time?
Yes. Yeah. And so they have the regular people, and then they have people like me who come in fairly regularly, and then they also have kind of the guest stars and stuff. Everyone is always amazing, super nice. Mark Hamill likes to read sometimes.
Yeah.
So sometimes we have to remind him where he is because he gets really involved in what he's doing. But I am obsessed with Sam. Sam is super quiet. And my favorite parts of watching Sam is that Sam does this thing where he has hand yes. positions for each character. And so when he does Pops, he does this. Yep. And when he does Muscle Man, he does this. And so he goes from here to this. And then what does he do for Benson? Benson, he does this. You're fired. You're fired.
Yeah.
And so I watch him constantly. And then we like to make out. And it's the best part of Starla and Muscle Man is that when we make out, everyone is so disgusted by it. I mean, like,
have you noticed they're letting you do that less? Have you noticed the show?
They've curbed our making out because we usually stand across the room from each other and we'll make out separately. So Sam will start the make out thing and he'll be like, and then I will come in and be like, and you look in the control room and everyone's going.
It's the best and worst thing ever.
Everyone's like physically just their skin are crawling. And so they actually got so disgusting that they stopped. They had to reel us back in. They said it cannot. I guess standards and practices had an issue because it was too wet sounding.
Yeah.
So now they're like only dry making out. So now it's like.
Yeah, it used to sound like all kinds of things going on over there. And it looked even sillier.
But Sam doesn't look at me when we're making out either. So it's perfect.
Well, I don't know if you could.
I stare right at him. I give him total eye contact, and he's just like, get away from me, lady.
When I look at you when you're doing that, I don't know that I could actually speak lines while you were.
I love it.
Okay, so the second part of my question is, if I were to go to the autograph session and pull out my phone and call my uncle, who is like crazy for regular show, Would you, Mr. Sayers, answer it and say, hi, I'm Rigby and all that?
Oh, hell no. Yes, of course I would.
I'll be there.
All right. Sure. What's your name?
Ethan.
Ethan? Okay. We'll see you over there.
But as part of the message, Rigby should tell him he should have bought a ticket to Supercon and just showed up.
You're going to have to get a creative
like
cut
the real
of this
thing,
call.
Baby.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Why isn't the uncle here if he's such a big fan?
Right?
Hi there.
Hi.
I was at my breakfast table one morning, and my children, who I am greatly embarrassing, were watching the show.
Uh-huh.
And I'm hearing all of this music from my childhood growing up.
Yep.
And now my kids raid my iTunes. So my question is, do you have any input on the music? Do they invite you into the brainstorming sessions and say, you know, I think Ballroom Blitz would be a great song for this segment?
No, the short answer is at least not for me. I don't get consulted about that. But they are. JG loves 80s music, and he has an encyclopedia. I lived through it, and he knows it better than I do. You know, there's an encyclopedic knowledge there, and there are. He's got a hit list of tunes that he wants to use. Some of them are beyond our reach. You know, it's amazing how much Led Zeppelin wants for a few bars.
Yeah.
But, we don't really have any input, but we don't really have to because, I mean, that guy is a font of 80s culture. It's an interesting thing to have been. I was a young man in the 80s, and these guys were kids in the 80s, and they have a nostalgia for a time when they had no responsibilities, you know what I mean? So like we see like the wrestling buddies and the music and all of that, the toys, the like the video games of the 80s. The writers and the creators love that. So they put as much of that in the show as they can.
Yeah, you know, my kids absolutely love that and they love your show and thank you so much.
Oh, I hope we see you at the signing.
Oh yeah, we're definitely coming.
Great.
Hello there.
Hello.
I have actually three questions. One, what year is it in a regular show? Me and a friend had an argument about that.
What year is it set in?
Yeah, what year is it in? Yeah.
It has never been discussed to my knowledge. They don't. There's this. As far as I know, it is in a time and place not unlike our own.
All right. Second question is, I know they had like Margaret, and Margaret was like supposed to date Mordecai, and then she went off to college. And now, I guess, in the newer shows, not to be a spoiler for anyone, Mordecai is dating CJ.
Yeah.
what are you going to do with Margaret? Are they just going to throw her out, or is she going to come back? It's going to be an awkward episode, or...
Well, we're both equally suited to answer this question because neither of us know. So, conjecture?
I have no idea, but I do find it really interesting that people are so angry at Margaret for going to college. She dirted him a little bit, but, like, I'm like, she's pursuing an education, and everyone's like, I don't care. She needs to stay there and be with him. I'm like, okay, well...
Doesn't she know how great he is?
Exactly. I think Mordecai's going to be just fine either way. Maybe they'll have a girlfriend who just is like, I mean, Mordecai has to man up a little bit, I think.
Absolutely.
You know? I mean, Mordecai. I think that's the problem.
Or bird up, whatever it is.
Yeah, he's inviting women who are ambivalent because he's ambivalent.
Here's the thing, though. I can tell you from experience that there's almost never a thread in regular show that simply gets dropped, that isn't followed up. The creators really pride themselves on, you know, remember that thing that happened 3 seasons ago? Well, now we're going to talk about it. So I think there's a good chance that we'll see something happening there.
This one is for William. Remember the episode where Mordecai, Rigby, and Skips went to a gaming contest? Do you remember the song? Do you remember that song that Rigby sang because... Mordecai is taking Skip instead of Rigby.
You're thinking about the one that goes something like, why do friends not take their friends to go with them to video game competitions when they know that they would want to do it? That one?
Yes, that one.
I can't sing that one.
Hi, guys.
Hello.
Speaking of being mad that Margaret went to college.
Yeah, I'm super
mad.
Go ahead,
darling.
we know her.
There was a statement you said online that Rigby's flaw is that he's sensitive and that he's always hurt. And I was just wondering why you said that. Like, why do you think he's sensitive?
Okay, this is a valuable lesson, kids. Don't drink and go online. I think whenever you see somebody who is that brash, I think they're covering up for insecurities. And I think that, I think it's his sensitivity that actually makes him likable. That's the difference between like Rigby and say, Eric Cartman. And I love Eric Cartman, right? But I wouldn't want to be around Eric Cartman. But I think that Rigby actually does care and he actually does kind of lead with his chin. And because of that, he has to do that thing that young males will do sometimes and be like, I don't care. Whatever. No, it's fine. I'm fine. Whatever. You know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Yeah. One more question. You guys know Penn, the creator of Adventure Time. There's this thing that Adventure Time is for kids who are facing, like, adult issues, and then regular show is for adults who still want to be kids.
So this is adults who are facing children's issues.
Yeah. So it's like, does that mean Penn faces, like, when he was a kid, like, did he face adult issues? And that mean, like, JG, like, he faced childish things while he was in college at art school? Like, does it go both ways?
You, young lady, are a deep well. I can't answer that because I don't know Penn that well. I could tell you that just from...
It's okay. It's a con.
It's so rude. It's so rude.
Stop talking!
I could tell you that the two of them, Penn and JG, outwardly present very differently. Like Penn's a very quiet dude, and he will. I have seen him meet somebody for the first time, and as he's talking, he sketches. Because I think that's how he's comfortable relating to the world. This is all completely theory, you know? And Penn's a super nice guy, but like he's very sort of like quiet. And JG's much more social and outgoing. What am I saying? Is that a thing? Yeah. That's not even a thing.
You were right both times.
Thank you.
He has nice, silky, floppy hair. That's all I know.
Yeah, he looks good. Did that answer your question?
Hi. First of all, I love both of you. I love Jack, and Morden is my favorite. I love Jack, even though she's a little intimidating.
What?
I was wondering, since they're such different characters for the regular show and Mass Effect, I was wondering if you put yourself in like a different mindset for different characters, like if you go back to like your childhood for Rigby and then like kind of like think differently for Morden.
That's a good question. Jack is just me. I think I'm fairly similar to Jack, if you get me on a bad day. And a good day as well. Starla is like a little more, she deals with a little more female issues, but she's also like, I always think about acting as being kind of a like a diamond where there's all these like different facets and you're still you, but you're kind of maybe showing one side versus another side versus another side. And so I think that's what allows actors to kind of tap into that kind of stuff. I
have used that exact analogy. I love you.
And I you.
Yeah, it's true. It's like my feeling is it's all in there. You know, there's like I said, I'm definitely the guy that wants to eat the last piece of pizza. I think there's something in that character that spoke to you and vice versa, or you wouldn't be playing the character, right? So, yeah, definitely. I'm definitely, I find myself going to sort of a very childlike, instinctive place to do Rigby. And for Morden, you know, I'm concentrating more on the part of me that is detached and scientific and at the same time wants to be of service.
And there are certain things that I never play, so apparently I don't ever get the scientific role, so apparently that facet is buried quite deep. But, yeah.
Hello.
Hey.
This question goes to William Salyers.
Okay.
My question is, what is like the, Ribby's cool, the, what his favorite things like going on skydiving or eating a burrito or eating chimichanga or anything else.
Why does he want to do that?
Yeah.
Well, in that particular episode, if you remember the way it started out, was he was getting ready to go back to his school reunion. And he found out that he came across this list of things that he was supposed to do by the time he was a certain age. And one of them was like, you know, become an NBA player, like moon someone in all 50 states or something like that. And Mordecai, he was like, oh man, the reunion's Wednesday. I've got to do one of these things before then. And Mordecai was like, well, I don't think you have time for this, this, or this. And one of the things that he had said he would do was skydive while eating a burrito. And so he thought maybe he had time for that one, and that's how that happened.
Okay, one last question. In Halloween special, what does work with me? Whoever, like, maybe I may have something like, maybe going to a haunted house.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, that's a great idea. The Halloween specials are my favorites, by the way. I love them because there are no rules. I mean, you know, the whole cast can die in the Halloween episode and then we're all back and it's no big deal. That's a great idea. You're welcome.
Which, by the way, isn't a good time to plug. What is your booth number? Where can they go see you for the signing?
One moment, please. Please stand by.
I'll have my staff look that up.
Oh, it's 1825 through 1833. I think
1825
to 83.
Yeah, it's just
there.
Right over here. There's a row, and they switch us out, so we're not sure exactly where, but it starts at 1825, and it's kind of just right over there.
In this room?
Yeah.
Yes.
So probably right the way I've been having the audience navigate, see the top of the columns, there's a 50, there's a 51. You're in that neighborhood.
Yeah, exactly.
Tweet me if you can't find me. I'll have my phone on.
Hi, guys. I just wanted to say thank you for being with us today. I love you guys so much. You're so talented, and I love the show so much.
Oh, you're so sweet.
Thank you.
My first question is for William. We all know that Rigby and Mordecai are best friends. So what's your relationship in real life with J.G. Quintel?
That's a good question. Actually, J.G. is the hardest working man in show business. So I don't think he sees anybody very often. We tend to socialize mostly on the rare occasions that he has time to go to an event like San Diego Comic-Con or something like that. But he's really, really busy, and I don't think too many people hang out with him at all. We get along great. I think he gets along great with everybody. I think that's just who he is. But we actually don't hang out a lot, you know, and the relationship between Mordecai and Rigby, I think, is kind of based on his relationship with Sam, because they went to school together at Caltech. I mean, not CalArts, Caltech. That'd be a very different show.
Yeah.
then they'd be like, we'd be talking about nuclear energy or something. But no, they went to school together.
And my second question is, can we have a funny conversation between Rigby and Starla and Eden? Rigby says, stop talking.
That might get Rigby killed. Hey, Starla.
What?
Where's Muscle Man?
Mitch? I think Mitch is actually going to plan our date for this evening.
That's awesome. Well, I'm looking for him because Benson says if we don't get the work done, we're all going to be fired.
Mitch has more important things to do. Mitch is planning our date. He's taking me to a very romantic restaurant, and it's really expensive.
Yeah, that must be why I didn't have enough cash to pay the tab for Wing Kingdom the other day.
We're not going to Wing Kingdom. We're going to a very fancy restaurant. We're going to dance and make out. It's going to be
Oh, Starla.
Awesome. We're just going to kind of...
Starla? Stop talking!
I was restrained because I have a lot of lip gloss on.
Hello.
Hi.
I just wanted to say first that I love both of your works in the Mass Effect series. It's amazing.
Thank you.
And I hope you haven't been asked this question yet. But when you were working on Mass Effect 3, how was it because it's basically the close of the series for those characters? Like, how did you feel towards the end of it?
I can't even talk about the last session. I mean, like yesterday in my Q&A, someone asked about that. And I started to tear up because I actually, my last session as Jack, I was crying. Caroline Livingstone, who was directing me, was crying in Canada. I was filled with dread because I knew she was coming to an end. And I really, really knew I was so lucky playing her that I wanted her to go on forever. And when they were like, okay, we got a couple more sessions, I was like, no. And I don't think I've ever felt so... I have a lot of, like, torment about things sometimes that I do. Like, I'm very, like, I don't know if that's good. I don't know. You know, like, I doubt myself. And with Jack, I didn't. It was... Jack was, like, riding the wave, like, when you get up on a surfboard and you're like, oh, this is why everyone's out here in the freezing cold, because it's awesome. Yeah. And with Jack, I felt like I was surfing all the time. And to end up getting tossed off the surfboard was painful. But it was so sweet. I mean, I know that I was so lucky to have the opportunity that, you know, you can't, it's when it's over, it's bittersweet. But yeah.
And for me, that was further complicated by the fact that I had taken over this role. And, you know, by the time that I was recording it, and I had several sessions, I knew the history of it a little bit. I knew that it had been created by this actor named Michael Beatty. I'd gone online and I'd listened to, I'd seen cutscenes from Mass Effect 2. I was in Mass Effect 2, but I didn't play Morden Solis. And it was part of what felt odd about it to me, aside from the fact that it was just one of the most delicious scenes I'd ever been able to play in anything, was that I felt like it was kind of unfair that the guy who had created the character didn't get to see it through to the end. And I don't know why that didn't happen, but I certainly, I feel like... I feel like I got the rich center of the nougat, you know, that he didn't get to do. Yeah. But I was remarkably moved by the character. Playing that death scene was actually difficult, and my experience with Caroline was kind of similar when she was directing me.
Right. Thank you so much. You guys are amazing.
Oh, you're
welcome.
For
coming.
So, after hearing my question, how often do you get to improvise?
How often do we get to improvise? That's a good question. In my first show, Moral Oral, that was claymation that was animated to our dialogue. And so I played a character named Reverend Putty, and he would often have these humorous sermons, and I would actually just stand at a podium with the mic and just do them. And then they would animate the character to that. And I could certainly throw in lines. I could do... had a great deal of freedom. Not so much with regular show, because it's what's called a storyboard-driven show, meaning that the writers are also the artists who are actually creating the picture. And we have to conform more to what they're doing. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
As far as, I mean, obviously, I'm not in a position to really do a lot of improvising on regular show as I'm not a regular cast member, but with video games, most of the time, it's very tightly scripted as well. I'm working on one right now, actually, and I think this is kind of a newer trend in video games that they're actually really wanting me to bring my spin to this player character. And so instead of, they particularly want, instead of having your typical player character that's like, you know, go left, do this, you know, very neutral, they want a character. And I think that that is maybe based on Mass Effect or just a natural progression with video games, but that they will generally say, give me two takes, and I can usually throw in like a third, or on the second one, I can throw in my own spin on it, add in a few swear words or something. And the nice thing is that, always with the swears, the nice thing is that with those things in particular, if you do what's called pre-life, so you might start, especially if the music on a line isn't really working for you and you can kind of hear it clunking, they'll let you do it again and say, like, do a little pre-life. And so you can be like, ah, dude, and then say the line. As long as you give them an edit point, they can either keep that pre-life in there or they can edit it out, as long as you give them just a little wiggle room.
That's fascinating, so, Courtney. What video game is that?
Check back with me in like a year.
Yeah, I'm totally.
But it is, it's a nice trend. So we get to, you know, put a little more spin on it. And video games, that traditionally wasn't the way.
So that's a quote from the video game you're not allowed to talk about.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's hilarious to watch, you know, people who have known each other and worked together in business for years, like they'll be in a room together and they'll be like, so what are you working on? Are you doing anything? Yeah, yeah, doing a game. Oh, good, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
What kind of game?
It's one with the shooting.
Oh, shooter game, really?
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
Wait, what kind of shooter game is it? Is it like, does it involve, I don't know, like is it like a specific kind of shooter game?
I guess you could say orcs. You could say that it's a...
Oh, yeah. You try and give each other hints.
You just
turned into Mark Hamill.
Yeah. Yeah. That's exactly right. I mean...
Because when you go through all the hemming and hawing, it sounds like you don't actually know what game you're on. Why doesn't anybody just say, I'm not allowed to say?
Well, sometimes we don't know what game we're on, actually.
Okay. I've actually figured it out. I don't know if I told you this. I've actually figured it out by going into a session and having someone say, oh, we had Courtney in here yesterday. And then Courtney and I are in the same game. But you sign what's called an NDA. Here's how ridiculous it is. They will send out the project under a false name. So you get this game like, okay, you're reading for this new game, Topaz, or whatever. And, you know, you've never heard of Topaz. You don't know who's doing Topaz. There's no pre-press about Topaz. That's because it's really, you know, Star Wars 72 or whatever. But you don't have the actual game name. And then before you can read for it, you have to sign a non-disclosure and send it back to your agent.
Don't talk about the thing you don't know anything about.
That's exactly right.
But we have a nice trend because actually Bill and I have started to work together on... So we have iCarly. Yep. We have regular show.
We have, and we just did, we just got to work on a great game called Evolve.
Shh. He's telling secrets right now.
Spoilers.
It's not really a secret. I've been told I could talk about it.
Yeah. So we are, and I think we've done a couple others. So we've done Mass Effect as well. And so I think we're kind of,
yeah.
At this point, we're kind of a work couple. It's yeah. Nice. Sorry, if Nancy's out there, I love him like a brother.
Yeah, exactly. And she's not. She's sleeping.
On the beach. She's like...
asleep in the hotel.
Hi. I have a question for both of you. What made you come up with the voices for like Rigby and Starla? Like, what made the voice come to you?
That's a great question. How did we come up with the voices? You wanna? Because your voice is very distinctive for that.
I don't know exactly where she came from, but the director locked her in for me when she said, "Oh, it's that Harvey Fierstein voice you did," and then I was like, "Oh, she is kind of Harvey Fierstein," and so that was maybe in the back of my mind. I do like him, and I have, you know, I like kind of male characters playing females and vice versa. I always like funny twists on things. So I think that's kind of where she came from for me, was being able to utilize the gravel in my voice that usually people are like, oh, no, 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 we want you to sound like a fairy princess. And I'm like, I can't do it. And then, so I actually got to be like, yes. And actually, hold on one second. Have they done Starla's sister? Have they done that episode?
I don't think so.
Okay. Forget it.
And as far as Rigby goes, again, you know, I was just sort of informed by the lines. I mean, he seemed like a really angsty dude, and I knew it was a cartoon, and I wanted to do something kind of lively, and so that's where, rather than, you know, going down with it and being, you know, like this kind of angsty, and it, you know, I wanted to do something sort of like higher pitch. So that's kind of where it came from.
And Rigby is nothing if not lively.
He is lively, yes. I like to say
high spirited.
He's me on way too much caffeine.
Hello.
Hello.
This is a question specifically for William. I'm sorry, I can't pronounce your last name.
Nobody can. Just call me Bill.
Bill. Hi, Bill.
Hey, what's your name?
My name is Francesco.
You're gonna give me grief about my name. No, go ahead, Francesco.
Just call me Frank.
All right, Frank.
So, specifically, this is from Mass Effect 3 question, from Morn Solis. During that scene with the line, I made a mistake, that scene really resonated with me. I specifically did not kill Morden just because of that scene, even if I was building a bad character.
Yeah.
So my question for you is, did you have any emotional reaction during that scene? Because I felt something really emotional from that character when he said that.
Oh, for sure. I mean, I don't think you get to be an adult human without being able to emotionally engage in a statement like I made a mistake. You know, now, you know, more granted, it doesn't always involve genocide, but I think it's pretty and that's one of the great things about acting, in my opinion, is that people often think that you're putting on a mask. Acting is really taking them off. So you know, you get to be a version of yourself that you would never share with people, and they think you're just playing a role. So yes, I totally connected with that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I share Jack.
What?
I share Jack.
You share Jack.
This is why I'm always very afraid when we get on the stage, actors who are really good at playing psychopaths.
Yeah, I think you should be. Yeah,
they're really good at being crazy.
Well, that's one of the things that I've sort of fallen away. I'm not as good at this as Courtney is. You know, Courtney's like keeping a finger in every pie. I kind of moved away from the TV thing, not only because it was depressing, but because if you're of a certain age and follically challenged, you end up being a I could pretty much be a doctor, a lawyer, or a psychopath. And which I guess is a kind of lawyer, really. Yeah. But yeah, you're exactly right. It's like
psychopaths have more ethics. they won't kill anyone.
Not for money, anyway.
No.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
Here's a question for both of you. Out of all the episodes of Regular Show, which one would be your favorite?
I said this yesterday, but I loved the pie contest one. I loved it because it actually has like a little bit of like a moral to it, as far as like, how do you deal with when someone is so excited about something and it sucks? And like, you know, being, of course, you know, how do you navigate that? And also because it was Promise Pie.
It was Promise Pie.
And I'm obsessed with Promise Pie. And like when JG did that voice, I just was like, oh.
How there is not an action figure, I don't know.
I know. I came home and was like waking up in the middle of the night being like, Promise Pie. I'm Promise Pie.
I'm sure your husband slept with one eye open during that time.
He's used to me being a psychopath.
And for me, I know this is so cliche. It's such a hard question because I literally laugh out loud at least once every time I read a storyboard. Like every time there's something that I go, oh my God, that's hilarious. And so I have a particular fondness for the Halloween episodes. And I have a particular fondness for any episode during which Rigby does something stupid, which then results in him dying or nearly dying. So that would be like when he gets the Placo arm boy and beats Skip's arm wrestling, and then Skip's realizes it and he like takes it away from him and kills him essentially by arm wrestling. I like that. But one of my favorite episodes was one that I wasn't even in that much, was Excellent, which was the episode that we won the Emmy for. It was just the idea that Rigby would try to eat a giant omelet to win a trucker's hat when it turns out he's allergic to eggs. It's just so perfectly stupid. So that's my multi-tiered answer to your simple question.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm pretty good. How are you? I mean, how are you? How are both of you? Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Yeah, you're good? How are you?
Nervous.
Don't be nervous.
I'm staring lovingly at the unicorn behind you in line. Sorry, I got distracted.
Wow, now I'm nervous.
This is a question for both of you. I was wondering, what is your opinion on Rigby's and Eileen's relationship right now?
Oh, wow. Go ahead.
I am super excited if Rigby will pull it together. I cannot wait to see how this spools out.
It's going to be so wonderfully awkward. And I figure it's going to happen. And again, we don't know, but I figure it's going to happen because at this point, Rigby has given Mordecai so much grief about his romantic...
the comeuppance is going to be amazing.
Yeah, exactly. You know, Rigby says, you know, he's like, you know, just do it, man. Come on. What's wrong with you? I think that when the shoe's on the other foot, he's going to, like, want to burrow into a hole.
He's going to get stepped on.
One more question. When we go get autographs, I was wondering if you can give me some sugar.
I hate Don!
All right, I gotta do my final question here because we're running out of time.
Oh, but I have to hear the unicorn's question because I want to know how the unicorn talks.
What does the unicorn say?
Yeah, what does the unicorn say?
Did you ever romance Jack?
Have I ever romanced Jack? No, but I have met so many people at like weddings and like birth like celebrations and stuff where people have been like, "Hi, nice to meet you. I've had sex with you," and I'm like, "That's great. Are you on the bride's side or the groom's side?" It's super creepy. And also, I have to take the question. We have to take the question because I skipped someone because I wanted to hear you talk. So, really quickly.
Can each of you imitate the voices from regular show? Like, Courtney would imitate Rigby and William.
She want a Courtney version of Rigby.
Okay, all right.
Bill version.
Well, I play Rigby's mom, and so I tried. I did try and do it. My Rigby sucks, but I would do something like, "Stop talking!"
Now I'm thinking she should have gotten the role. And I would do something like this, which is my closest to... Oh, Mitch!
It sounds like Rigby with lipstick on.
Yeah, I think it's good that they like cast Pete it the Puma. Way they did, yeah.
Your That's version great. Of the Bugs Bunny girly bunny?
Totally, I was just like...
All right, Supercon, big round of applause.
Thank
Bill
you, guys.
Courtney. Guys. Come see us.